So theatre has been connected with politics since the very beginning of its existence. Tragedies like Aeschylus' Persians or Euripides' Trojan Women reflected older or more recent history, and Aristophanes' comedy repeatedly referred to contemporary political life as in the nights. Shakespeare's plays have often been related to politics, which is no wonder, since more than half of them refer directly or allude to local and foreign political history from the Greek antiquity to Henry VIII. From the use of Richard III by Essex's followers to support his conspiracy against Elizabeth I in 1601, to Laurence Olivier's film of Henry V, dedicated to the British soldiers of World War II, the Bard's dramatic works have been given new political contexts in Britain as well as elsewhere in the globe. In 21st century Greece, Shakespearean productions are only occasionally connected with politics. In 2014, A. Pappagambinus's Richard II focused on the similarities between the Shakespearean play and the current political condition in the country. Earlier on, in 2011, Stella Marie created a performance called Hamlet Committed Suicide, where excerpts from Hamlet were aptly used to illustrate the financial disaster of Greece. Today's Greek stage directors seem to focus on creating a fresh aesthetics rather than providing new political readings of Shakespeare's plays. However, the Bard is highly quoted or referred to in various contexts, both Greek and foreign, related to contemporary politics in Greece. This paper will explore a variety of references to Shakespeare's plays in recent Greek political speech, articles about late 20th and 21st century politics in Greece, as well as satirical programs of the last decades focusing on the current financial crisis in the country. One of the most interesting articles about recent politics in Greece is Thomas Tsalapatis's PASOK and Shakespeare. PASOK is the Socialist Party. Though written during the Greek crisis in 2014, it is not directly related to it. However, it is worth mentioning as the most elaborate example of Shakespearean quoting in an article on recent Greek politics. The author uses no less than 10 Shakespearean plays, Richard II, Macbeth, Hamlet, Richard III, Coriolanus, Henry IV, Part II, Timon of Athens, King Lear, Othello, The Merchant of Venice, to illustrate the history of the Greek Socialist Party. Tsalapatis' article is a fine example of how topical the Bard can be. Quote, "The microgeography of power," the author argues, "permeates every Shakespearean play, told in all its versions and variations as desire, punishment, loss, gain, or nemesis, in terms at times political, ethical, or existential." It is not absurd, then, if we accept the characterization of Shakespeare by his colleague and friend Ben Jonson as the poet not of an age but for all time, to examine the forms of power in any era through the prism of a Shakespearean text, the characters, the bonds, and the conflicts he bequeathed to human narration. End of quote. More specifically, Tsalapatis observes a series of political phenomena starting with nepotism in Greek political life and the alternation of a few political families in the country's government, recalling the words of Queen Margaret and Richard III in an excerpt where the same names appear again and again. "I had an Edward till Richard killed him. I had a Harry till Richard killed him. Thou hadst an Edward till Richard killed him. Thou hadst a Richard till a Richard killed him." The author also refers to Andreas Papandreou, the founder of PASOK, as Papandreou II, in Shakespearean terms, as he says, alluding to the first politician of the family, Georgios. Tsalapatis repeatedly uses quotes from Hamlet to draw parallels between Rosencrantz and Guildenstern and Papandreou's operational adjutants, Aristotle and Kostas, to underline Papandreou's popularity, which enabled him to be re-elected with a 47% after a massive financial scandal, and to underscore the corrupting power of money during his government, also quoting from Timon of Athens. The author proceeds with a history of PASOK, paralleling Kostas Sinikis, the next prime minister from the party, with Othello, or Shylock, arguing that he was seen as some kind of damned other, a misfit within the socialist and populist PASOK. The author observes that, like his Shakespearean counterparts, Simitis, though apparently odd, managed to impose himself. On the contrary, the author continues, his successor, George Papandreou, recalls the impotent descendant of powerful leaders, a figure coming from the most worn knight romances, since the only identity he has to show is a surname. Here Telepathis quotes from Richard III, betwixt the titles and low name, there's nothing differs but the outward frame. Telepathis discerns yet more parallels with Shakespearean characters in the long gallery of Pasokian politicians. He regards Theodoros Pangalos, an obese member of the party, as an inverted Falstaff who, instead of jokes, utters misanthropic witticisms. He sees the eloquent Evangelos Venizelos, who eventually became the leader of PASOK when the party had already lost most of its power in the electorate, speaking an infinite deal of nothing, that's what the Merchant of Venice, and Andreas Papandreou's second wife, Dimitra Liani, as a distasteful Lady Macbeth. Unlike Telepathis, most Greek authors quote from one play only, the most popular being Hamlet, and so do politicians, too. In one of his speeches as president of PASOK, Evangelos Venizelos, making the common mistake of connecting to be or not to be with Yorick's skull, remarked that the Hamletian dilemma while looking at the party's skull had to stop. Antonis Kamakis, in the satirical TV show Radio Arvila, commented that the Hamletian dilemma is obviously to be or not to be, and proposed, referring to the future of PASOK, not to be. Hamlet as a figure, along with his dilemma, also features in articles about the Greek financial crisis. In his piece, A Hamlet of the Left, Takis Theodoropoulos regards the Greek Prime Minister Alexis Tsipras as a counterpart of Hamlet, considering the internal pressure he has to suffer due to the crisis. On the other hand, Vasilis Kapsaskis, in his article The Pre-Election Dilemmas and Shakespeare, presents the point of view of the Greek people. The real dilemma that is formed is not an opportunistic political trick, a sign and consequence of the times. It is not chaos or absolute majority what should bother us about the next day, but an imperative dilemma of life or death, a Shakespearean to be or not to be, where in place of the skull in Hamlet's hands, gapes the miniature of our own personal Greece, everyone's Greece. Again, the famous Hamletian quote is wrongly connected with the graveyard scene. The second most popular quote from Hamlet, something is rotten in the state of Denmark, also appears in texts about the crisis. In his article, Something is Rotten in the Eurozone Kingdom, published in the Financial Times, the former Greek Minister of Finance, Yanis Varoufakis, focuses on the European part of the Greek crisis in an article too technical to discuss here. Apart from Hamlet, the Shakespearean play that was apparently considered as the most relevant to the Greek financial crisis was The Merchant of Venice, for obvious reasons. Another politician of the ruling party of Syriza, Panos Tsourolakos, in his article Creditors or The Merchant of Venice, in the newspaper Avgi, commonly regarded as the mouthpiece of the party, draws a parallel between Greece's creditors and Shylock, and makes the connection between Antonio and every Greek citizen from whom the creditors require a pound of flesh. Nevertheless, he concludes, the time of the court has come, the time to discuss about the debt and the penalty. This article was published just a few days after Syriza took on the government. Unfortunately for Skouroulakos himself, his party, and the Greek citizens, the new government hasn't yet managed to change much regarding the country's debt. Well before Syriza came into power, Vasilis Drupopoulos, professor of political economy at the University of Athens, in his article entitled When the Merchant of Venice Meets the Usurers of Today, traced similarities between the Venetian loaning system as described in Shakespeare's play and Greece's current loan contracts. Professor Georgopoulou argues that now, as then, a loan contract between two parts does not take into consideration factors such as values or ethics. In this case, he concludes, the blood flows and deaths are caused not due to the delayed payoff, but rather with the payoff of the debts on time. The anonymous blogger of Tromaktiko, Scary, in an article with the title Shylock, Our Flesh, Madame Merkel and Cyprus, also traces similarities between Shylock and Greece's creditors. Moreover, after giving a summary of the play, the blogger draws detailed parallels between the characters and people or situations involved in the current financial crisis in the country. And I've got a long quote here. What is the relation of all this to current reality? Just put next to every role one of today's protagonists of the crisis. Portia is a good life who led with loans for three decades. Bassanio is the average Greek who counts on his best friend to enjoy it. Antonio is a Greek government that thoughtlessly gives loans with no warranty in order to please its citizens' voters. The three boxes are the party's promises before the elections. The ships symbolize the loans and the risky investments in problematic enterprises, and the weather that makes them vanish is the invisible hand of the markets. Replace the 3,000 ducats with the 260 billions of euros of our debt. The princes of Morocco and Aragon are today's investors from Qatar and Russia. The part of the Venetian Doge could be played by José Manuel Barroso, and that of the court by the European Union. And, of course, the role of the bloodthirsty Shylock is rightfully enacted by the Troika, or if you wish to personalize it, the ruthless, after Alexis Tsipras, Madame Merkel. End of quote. Similar parallels are drawn in foreign articles, too. Robert Applebaum, in his piece The Merchants of Europe, remarks that Shakespeare's Merchant of Venice provides one of the best models for understanding the drama of the debt crisis in Greece today. The author explains that, the author explains the similarity between the two situations. In Shakespeare's play, he argues, quote, if once the principle of the need to repay all debts is abridged, the very principle that sustains the prosperity of the city of Venice will be undermined. And he continues, such has been, in fact, the publicly stated argument of the EU with regard to Greece. A bond is a bond and must be repaid. To forgive the bond would undermine the justice of the European economy. Written a month after Syriza came into power, Applebaum's article concludes with the fact that the new government has finally faced reality, consisting of, quote, the power of money over humanity, of Germany over Greece, of creditors over debtors, of banks over governments, of financiers over democracy, and of pitiless aggression over leadership and compassion. End of quote. J.J. Goldberg, in his article Connecting the Dots Between Greek Crisis, Argentina, and the Shylock Canard, comments on a parallel drawn by Cristina Fernandez de Kirchner, who compared the Greek financial crisis to Argentina's. Argentina's president, Goldberg observes, seems to believe that, quote, the two countries' crises have a lot in common. She believes they're both fighting the same good fight against predatory international financiers, she likes to call them vulture funds, who prey on weaker nations' economies, end of quote. However, the author argues that this is not exactly so, and I quote again. For one thing, Greece isn't actually fighting with predatory lenders seeking to profit from other people's misery. It's fighting with the European Union, which is trying to figure out how to get its most insolvent member state out of a hole. End of quote. And like the Greek authors who focus on the Greek's pound of flesh, Goldberg approaches the issue from the point of view of the country's creditors. A debate on Shakespeare also seems to underline that the similarities between the Merchant of Venice and the Greek crisis are debatable. Lawrence Weiss, having read Applebaum's article mentioned above, as it is made clear elsewhere in the debate, argues that, quote, the polemic equating the insistence by the European banks on repayment of the Greek debt with Shylock's claim of a right to kill his debtor is appalling, not to mention ignorant and irrational. In her reply, Julia Griffin underlines another factor regarding the relations between Germany and Greece. Given that the country pressing most loudly for the repayment of the Greek debt is one that imposed such immense hardship on Greece not that long ago, I find it hard to be appalled by Dr. Applebaum's plea for clemency. Of course, Griffin adds, the fact of the Axis occupation complicates the Shylock analogy still more. In yet another comment of his, Wise answers Griffin and tries to clarify the source of the problem by arguing that the current situation in Greece is not due to the Nazis, but rather to the Greek themselves, who, and I quote, for a generation or more, have funded their only generous welfare state with other people's money, while they lived well, worked little, and notoriously evaded their taxes, end of quote. Weiss goes so far as to propose a rather outrageous solution to the problem, at least in the eyes of any Greek reader. Quote, the fundamental difficulties with the Greek economy can probably be solved if Greece cedes the economically stagnant part of the country to neighboring states who have cultural and ethnic ties with them, end of quote. Then he concludes, but what has any of this got to do with Shakespeare? And likewise, Marianne Kimura finds that, quote, Robert Applebaum's idea to look into Shakespeare for insights into the Greek debt crisis is excellent, end of quote. However, her own reading of the play is rather irrelevant to the Greek crisis. A more relevant answer to Weiss is that by Applebaum himself. First, he comments on Weiss's proposed solution by reminding him that the division of the kingdom, usually into two or three regions, was a nightmare in Shakespeare's plays. And then he underlines Shakespeare's relevance. Quote, it is no secret that in plays like Merchant and Timon, Shakespeare explored the way in which money both ties people together and drives them apart. There are no solutions to the problem in Shakespeare, I believe, but there is an appeal to the values of compassion, concord, and respect for others in the face of all the conflicts of which human beings, including bankers and traders, are capable of involving themselves in, end of quote. Joseph Eggers, in his own comment, thanks Applebaum for his provocative comparison of the Greek debt crisis to the contest in The Merchant of Venice, but poses his own questions, quote, shouldn't Greece return the EU's pound of fiscal flesh back to the EU? And doesn't maturation demand a measure of fair and just discipline to counter the infantilizing indulgence of years past? End of quote. He also looks at the problem from the point of view of the European citizens involved in this affair. Quote, I wonder at Dr. A's faith in democratic process to override Greek debt. Does Dr. A truly believe a majority of all EU citizens would stand with Greece rather than with German Minister Schäuble and his nasty, unforgiving money men? Next to The Merchant of Venice, Timon of Athens, a play already mentioned in this context, is also seen as a parallel to the Greek crisis. In his article, Shakespeare and the Greek Tragedy of Capitalism, Scott Hamilton sees a Timon in every single newly homeless Greek. Richard II, also mentioned above, comes up again too. In his piece, Shakespeare and Syriza, Kostas Christidis comments, 400 years after the Shakespearean history play was written, the analogies with the current Greek reality are characteristic. Without the presence of a war or other natural catastrophe, the government constantly imposes taxes, levies, and poll taxes by inventing new tricks. End of quote. And yet, the members of the Greek cabinet seem to remain self-confident. Panagiotis Kouroubalis, Minister of Interior and Administrative Reconstruction, in an interview he gave last winter, stated that, quote, those who dream of elections and imply defections have midsummer night's dreams, though in the middle of winter. On the other hand, dealing with a problematic country is acknowledged as a difficulty by another member of the Greek cabinet in a cartoon by Dimitris Kantzopoulos in the newspaper Kathmerini, where Alekos Lamburaris, Minister of State, warns the Prime Minister Alexis Tsipras that, quote, the Midsummer Night's Dream is over, and now begins the taming of the shrew. As for the comic side of the coin, in episode 8 of her online true story entitled The Greek Way, Lila Stamboulou imagines how Shakespeare would have written his plays if he had considered the Greek crisis. On a more practical level, the team of Radio Avila, the TV show mentioned above, proposes a solution to the problem of mere survival faced by a large portion of Greek society. The imaginary dating agency under the name Grandpa Romeo and Grand Juliet enables Greek pensioners to join their pensions by living together in order to survive the financial difficulties. In the context of the Greek financial crisis, from both a serious and a comical point of view, Shakespeare once more proves as topical as ever. Thank you.
No, thank you.